So I'm going to present this project called Place-Based Redistribution, which is joint work with Pat Klein and Danny Yeyan. So here is some motivation for what we do. Governments around the world make widespread use of place-based policies. For instance, about a third of the European budget is dedicated to regional policy and shifts budget around from richer areas like Germany to poorer areas like southern Italy. And more generally, place-based policies can be found virtually everywhere in the world, in the US, in Canada, UK, France, Vietnam, Japan, etc. And these type of interventions are typically justified on two grounds. So first, they are advocated for efficiency reasons. They help internalize agglomeration externalities and congestion externalities. And second, they are also put in place for equity reasons. And places are heterogeneous, generally in income, in opportunities, and more generally in the environment they offer to people. And so place-based policies are therefore a way to transfer resources to the disadvantaged. So this latter motive for place-based policies is the focus of our paper. And that's in contrast to the bulk of the literature that has focused on the efficiency motive for place-based policies for the most part. So in our paper here, we're going to ask, does it make sense to index redistribution on place? So does place-based redistribution improve welfare? So a clear motivation for indexing redistribution on place is that poverty levels are very uneven across space, and that's true at all levels of aggregation. For instance, here you see a map of Chicago that represents the poverty rate of each tract in Chicago. And you see that poverty is strikingly concentrated in the west and the south side of Chicago, with poverty rates about 50%. And place-based policies, you know, typically target those type of high poverty areas. It's the case, for instance, in the US. If you think about the Empowerment Zones program, which is a prominent place-based policies initiated in 1993 in the US. And just to fix ideas, for that specific policy, the areas that are targeted by the policy cover about 1% of the population in the US. And the level of subsidy is about $3,000 per eligible full-time worker. Now, of course, one can legitimately think that the progressive income tax system and other income-based transfers that are in place in the US already redistribute to people in these poorer areas. And you can see that here, we are plotting here the map of Chicago again. And now for each zip code, you see the share of household or the share of filers who claim the EITC and hence have a negative income tax overall. And so in the west and the south side of Chicago, about half of filers are net recipients of the income tax system. And so, you know, in this context, really the question we're asking here is really, should south side residents get an extra transfer that is beyond these income-based transfers because they live on the south side or simply for living on the south side? And the traditional answer to this question is, well, no, we shouldn't index redistribution on place because of efficiency costs. And this view is summarized here by a quote by Ed Glaser in the quote that we reproduce here that says, help poor people, not poor places, is something of a mantra for many urban and regional economists. place-based aid is inefficient because it increases economic activity in less productive places and decreases economic activity in more productive places. So in this paper, we're going to re-examine this question by first noting that all forms of redistribution are in practice distortionary. So place-based redistribution has efficiency costs, but so does income-based redistribution, which distorts labor supply. And so just because place-based redistribution bears an efficiency cost does not mean that one doesn't want to use it. So there is an equity efficiency trade-off faced by place-based redistribution, just like there is another equity efficiency trade-off faced by the income tax. So the chief goal of our paper is going to be to understand the conditions under which place-based policies can improve the equity efficiency trade-off we face as a society relative to using income taxes alone. So we're going to derive and compare the equity efficiency trade-off of place-based and income-based taxation and show that place-based redistribution can usefully complement income-based redistribution. So for instance, we're going to show that indexing redistribution on place can provide similar equity gains at lower efficiency costs sometimes than the income tax. So for instance, that's going to be the case if there's a limited mobility of households or when there is a limited productivity loss from moving. So in this case, place is a tag that allows for more efficient targeting of redistribution. And also, we're going to show conditions under which place-based redistribution can lead to unique targeted benefits in the sense that it can reach populations that the income tax can't. So this is going to happen, for instance, when the planner wants to redistribute within earnings across places. So that's something that the income tax cannot do. And that could happen, for instance, if a utilitarian planner wants to make transfer within income groups to households who live in, for instance, crime-infested areas. And then finally, we're going to put all of these arguments together and conduct a calibration exercise designed to answer the following question: how big might the optimal place-based subsidy be if we already had an optimal income tax system in place? So if place-based redistribution, and I'm going to stop saying that, I'm going to say PBR for place-based redistribution. So if PBR is dominated by income taxation, then the answer to this question could be just zero. The optimal PBR is zero. But we find instead that the answer in our example that's admittedly stylized, as you'll see, is about $4,000 per capita per year as a transfer to the 1% of people who live in the poorest tracts in the US. So, you know, this finding is subject to a lot of caveats. We're going to conduct various sensitivity analyses, and we have more work to do on this, but I'd be really happy to hear any suggestions you would have on this quantification exercise in particular. So then I have a few words to say about the related literature. So I already mentioned in introduction, we have a long, interesting literature that studies place-based policies, but the bulk of the literature, including my own work, focuses on efficiency motives for place-based policies. And here, in contrast, we're going to study equity motives. And so in that sense, we are closer to the public finance literature that studies tagging or that studies optimal taxation, and in particular, the literature on tagging and the literature following Atkinson and Stiglitz and Saez 2002 that studies conditions under which indirect commodity taxation is perhaps superfluous or perhaps a useful complement to income-based taxation. And so we transpose these questions to the context of place-based taxation, and show why place is special. So here is a roadmap for the paper. I'm going to first walk you through the theoretical analysis and investigate what is the role of a PBR. Then we're going to derive a formula for the optimal PBR and provide a test for comparing the effects of place-based tax reforms to income-based tax reforms. And finally, I'm going to walk you through this calibration exercise that aims to quantify the optimal PBR in the empirical context of the US. Okay, so here is the setup of our model. The model is going to combine key elements from two literatures, from urban and from public finance. So first of all, households are going to be heterogeneous in their skill indexed by theta. And that skill, importantly, is going to be unobserved by the government. Given their skill level, households are going to make a choice of labor supply that's going to lead to a choice of income, Z star. And that level of income is going to be observed by the government and taxed. And that's going to lead to distortive effects of taxation on labor supply. Then second, households are also going to have heterogeneous preferences for locations. And again here, and so this idiosyncratic taste for location is going to be summarized by this epsilon J that each household draws, and J is going to be a location. So again here, the shocks are not going to be observed by the government, but rather households who know their shocks are going to make a location choice on that basis, and then residential choices, J star, are going to be observed. So we have a unit mass of households. Each household is summarized by the characteristic I just talked about that are going to be summarized in a vector big theta. So that has both the skill and the preference for location. And this big theta is going to be distributed according to some distribution big F in the population. So households derive utility first from consumption. They consume a traded good, C, that's homogeneous, freely traded, and we're going to take it as the numerator. And they also consume housing, H. Second, households derive directly utility from the amenity or quality of life of the place where they live. And that's going to be summarized by this term, AJ, where again, J is the location. And third, households face a disutility of supplying labor. So their labor supply, or hours worked, if you want, is directly summarized here by how much income household achieve, so that's the term Z here, divided by the wage rate, W, that household face. And notice that the wage rate itself is a function of the household skill theta, as well as of where household live and work. So that's summarized by J here. And finally, household have this idiosyncratic preference for location J. So household are going to choose to live and work in one of two locations indexed by J that can be 0 or 1. And we're going to call location 1 distressed as a mnemonic, as this is going to be the likely target of place-based redistribution. Households are going to choose to live either in distressed or in elsewhere, and elsewhere is going to be location 0. Distressed and elsewhere differ in 3 dimensions. First, they differ in their amenities or quality of life, and we assume to fix ideas that amenities are going to be higher in elsewhere than in distressed. Second, distressed and elsewhere also perhaps differ in their productivity. So we're going to assume that at every skill level, the wage rate that household can have is going to be weakly higher in elsewhere than in distressed. And finally, the two locations also differ in their housing rents. Housing rents are called RJ. So we're going to assume that R0 is larger than R1. So households choose their earnings Z, their consumption, and their location J to maximize utility subject to their budget constraint. And households are going to be taxed based in principle both on their income Z and on their place of residence J. And so T is going to be the tax here. So there's going to be a benevolent planner that maximizes a social welfare function that is as follows. So the planner is utilitarian and going to maximize this welfare function where each household is going to have a Pareto weight omega of theta. And V star indicates indirect utility here. So for convenience, we're going to use the expectation sign as a notation to indicate the summation over all households in the economy. So with this utilitarian social welfare function, so long as V is concave, the planner is going to have preferences for redistribution from high consumption household to low consumption household. The Pareto weights allow for the planner to have other general preferences for redistribution over and above this one. So it's going to be useful to define the following concept. Lambda of theta is going to be the social marginal welfare weight of household theta. It's going to measure the welfare benefit of transferring one additional dollar to household theta. And it's going to be expressed in terms of the cost of public funds. So as you see in the expression for lambda, it depends on the Pareto weight of the household and on the marginal utility of income of household theta. But overall, it's important to remember that lambda, in everything that follows, is a measure that summarizes the equity benefits of transferring an additional dollar to a given household theta. So to achieve, to maximize the social welfare function, the planner uses two redistributive tools. So first of all, she uses an income tax, T of Z, that we assume is only based on income. So it is place blind and it's going to apply identically to both locations. Now, starting from a given place-blind income tax system, the planner considers implementing an additional simple place-based redistribution scheme, or PBR. This place-based redistribution scheme is going to take a very simple form. Residents in distress, so location one, are going to receive a per capita lump sum transfer of delta, which is the size of the program, divided by S, the number of people who live in distress. And this lump sum subsidy is going to be financed by also a lump sum tax on every resident of elsewhere, so that overall this PBR scheme is going to be ex-ante budget neutral. And the question we want to ask is, what is the first order welfare effect of a small PBR reform starting from this place blind tax system? And our first result is that this first order effect on welfare of a PBR is as follows. And I'm going to detail these terms one by one. But so that overall, implementing a place based tax reform is going to improve welfare if and only if this expression is positive. So what is this welfare effect? So first of all, this first term here is the equity gain from implementing a place-based redistribution scheme. So implementing PBR is going to lead to a direct impact on welfare as it redistributes consumption from elsewhere to distressed. The corresponding equity gains are simply equal to the difference between the average lambda in distressed and the average lambda in elsewhere. And so long as there is sorting and higher earners sort more often in elsewhere, Lambda will be on average higher in distressed than in elsewhere. And so using PBR is going to yield equity gains. And we see that sorting therefore creates a rationale for spatial targeting of taxation. And we know that sorting is routinely observed in location decisions. And so in that sense, place is a can be used for as a tag for earnings potential of individuals. But if indexing taxation on place leads to these equity gains, it also leads to behavioral responses of household and hence potentially to efficiency costs. And those efficiency costs are the second term of the proposition reproduced here. So how do households respond to a PBR? Well, they're going to be incentivized to move to distressed, which has been made relatively more attractive by the tax reform. And the behavioral cost of the PBR therefore depends on how many people move, and that's this first term, DS over D delta, where again, S is the share of people living in distressed. And the efficiency costs are also going to depend, importantly, on the earnings losses that movers incur conditional on moving. That's the second term. And because of productivity differences between places, or maybe because of lower amenities or lower cost of living in distressed that would lead to reducing labor supply among when you move to distressed, movers perhaps see this net loss in earnings. So overall, the efficiency cost of the PBR depends on mobility responses as well as on the earnings responses conditional on moving. So we've established this general formula, but it's kind of useful to think through special cases of the model, and we're going to review a few of those stylized cases where this efficiency cost actually turns out to be exactly zero. And so in those cases, so long as there is some sorting between elsewhere and distressed, PBR is going to be unambiguously welfare improving, as it's going to yield equity gains at no efficiency costs. So here's the first example. It specializes the model to think about redistribution within a stylized city that's going to be comprised of two residential neighborhoods that are equidistant or have equal access to a common business district where people work. And in this model, if one taxes the affluent neighborhood and subsidizes the poor one, it's going to trigger some moves maybe between these two residential neighborhoods, but there's going to be no earning losses upon moving because movers keep the exact same access to their job. And therefore, this PBR will come at no efficiency costs. So a second interesting example is motivated by the notion that moving costs are estimated to be very high. So if you think about the work of Kennan and Walker, or more recently Bayer et al., that's what they find. And so recall that in our baseline model, households live both in distress and in elsewhere. And a reason why some households live in distress is that they have a high idiosyncratic preference for it. So in contrast here, we're going to assume that households live in distress not because they particularly like it, but because they are stuck there. So this version of the model assumes that at any skill level, the utility in distressed is going to be strictly smaller than the utility in elsewhere. But the moving costs is higher than this utility difference, and therefore no household in distress moves to elsewhere, and so that's an initial equilibrium. So in this example, assume that we now put in place a PBR. Well, what's going to happen is that it's not going to trigger any migration to distressed, because no household want to pay a moving cost to move from a more desirable location that's elsewhere to a less desirable location that's distressed. And therefore, PBR is going to trigger no move, hence again, come at no efficiency cost. So the last example I wanted to talk about is a bit different. It focuses on the comparative advantage of high skills in large cities, emphasized in the literature, as well as the fact that the skilled jobs are clustered more and more in these large booming cities. So you can think, for instance, of Enrico's work on this topic. So to capture these notions in a very stylized way, we're going to assume that high-skilled jobs are only offered in elsewhere, while low-skilled jobs are offered at the in both locations, in elsewhere and in distressed, at the same low wage. So in this world, even after a place-based redistribution scheme, high-skilled workers are not going to move. They're going to stay where their jobs are, which is in elsewhere. Now, some low-skilled workers are going to be incentivized to move to distressed by this subsidy, but this move is not going to change their wage. And so given that there is no earning losses of movers, PBR, again here, is going to bear no efficiency cost in this stylized world. So these examples are going to be stylized, show that place-based redistribution can arguably deliver equity gains without necessarily bearing large efficiency costs. So I'm going to now come back to this, to the general model. We have shown a few slides ago the first order effect of starting to put in place a little bit of place-based redistribution, starting from a place-blind income tax system. And the model allows us to go further and derive a formula for the optimal level of place-based redistribution. And that's this formula here. So basically, the planner wants to increase place-based redistribution up until the case where when additional equity gains are going to be outweighed by additional efficiency costs. And that's going to pin down the optimal PBR, delta star, according to this formula. So intuitively, things are going to work as before. The optimal PBR is going to be higher when you have low mobility, low earnings losses from movers. It's also going to be higher when there is more sorting. Okay, so let me take stock here. And so what we've shown until now is really that we've tried to think about when is it desirable to implement some place-based redistribution, starting at a given income tax schedule, taken as is. But now it could be that rather than wanting to introduce this place-based redistribution scheme, the planner could actually do better by reforming the tax system and making the income-based tax system and making it better. And so, you know, we now explore this comparison between place-based redistribution reform and an income tax reform. And we ask this kind of more stringent question. So when is it the case that a place-based tax reform is going to be more efficient than an equivalent, in a way, income-based tax reform? And so to move forward, we're going to compare our PBR tax reform to an income tax reform that is similar in some dimensions. It's going to levies exactly the same tax at each level of income than the place-based redistribution scheme. So for a given level of income, recall that the place-based redistribution scheme taxes people in elsewhere in zero and subsidizes those in one. So that on average, at income level Z, people are taxed on net according to how many of them live in elsewhere versus distressed. And so formally, one can easily show that a comparable income tax that taxes exactly the same on average income by income depends on the share of household at each level of income who live in distressed versus elsewhere. And the formula is reproduced here. And so this tax reform, implementing this tax reform, is going to be a progressive tax reform. And so at least so long as high earners sort into elsewhere. So we're going to consider the place-based tax reform and this comparable income tax reform, and we're going to compare their effects on welfare. We're going to decompose it into a difference in equity benefits and a difference in efficiency costs. And so assume for a moment that overall this difference is positive. Then it's going to mean, in particular, that PBR is desirable over and above even an optimally chosen income tax. Indeed, if you start at an optimally chosen income tax, then any income tax reform is going to yield zero welfare gains by optimality. So the second term is going to be zero. So if this difference is positive, in that case, it means that the PBR reform in itself was welfare improving. And so again, this is a more stringent test for the desirability of place-based redistribution. So I'm going to go ahead and compute those two terms. So first of all, we're going to compute the difference in equity gains between the PBR and the comparable income tax reform. So recall that the PBR in isolation leads to equity gains that depend on whether the lambdas, the welfare gains of redistributing an additional dollar to that person, tends to be higher in distressed than in elsewhere. And so another way to summarize it formally is to write that these equity gains depend on the covariance between the lambda and the location choice J star. But now the income tax reform can replicate part of this equity gain, the part that corresponds to redistribution between earnings, right? Because that's what the income tax does. So net of the tax reform, net of the income tax reform, we can show that the net equity gains of PBR is going to still depend on some covariance between lambda and J and the location, but now within earnings or conditional on earnings. So to assess the unique equity benefits of PBR, one has to ask, is it the case that households who live in distressed have a higher marginal utility of income than those in elsewhere, but conditional on having the same earnings? And there are several reasons why that might be the case. And so to make that clear, we're going to concentrate on a utility function where labor supply decisions are going to be separable, hence do not interact with the marginal utility of income. And this is going to allow us to focus on the role played by differences in cost of living between places and differences in amenities between places in generating these heterogeneous marginal social welfare weights, lambda, within income. So we're going to consider a utility function here where you have this concave aggregator psi that aggregates consumption and amenities. And consumption, for simplicity, is going to be a homothetic aggregate of consumption of the traded good and of housing. So in this setting, one can show the following. So the fact that prices in elsewhere are higher than prices in distressed can lead to higher social welfare weights in distressed, conditional on income. And the reason is as follows. So on the one hand, households with a common income Z are richer in real terms in distressed, where prices are lower. So that would suggest that you want to redistribute away from them and to elsewhere. But on the other hand, spending a nominal dollar in distressed goes further in buying consumption, again, because prices are lower. So the nominal dollar spent by the government, it kind of goes further if you spend it in distressed. And overall, which one of these two effects dominate depends on the concavity of psi. So unless this concavity is too high, the dollar goes further in buying consumption effect, dominates. And welfare weights are going to be higher, conditional on income in distress. So we have also a second separate reasons why redistributing, again, within earnings across places might be desirable, and that comes from amenities. And this is going to happen when the fact that amenities are lower in distress makes the marginal utility of consumption higher in distress, all else equal. So formally, it's going to happen if consumption and amenities are Q substitutes, again, another condition on site. But the idea that this captures is as follows, for instance. So assume that distress has a high crime rate. Then one would need, for instance, car rides or Uber rides to drive their kids home safely, more so in distress than in elsewhere. And indeed, high poverty regions tend to be also low amenity areas or high disamenities areas, really. And the type of disamenities that could arguably raise the marginal utility of consumption there. So here on the left-hand side, I'm showing you again a map of Chicago, but now showing crime rates. And so you see that there's no doubt that the West and the South side have this really high crime rate here. And on the right-hand side, we're showing you the now a nationwide measure of how polluted tracks are as a function of their poverty rate. So you see in this simple correlation that higher poverty tracts, on average, tend to be more polluted than low poverty tracts. So people who live in high poverty tracts live in highly polluted areas. And again here, this could rise the marginal utility of consumption in distress as the population has now higher healthcare needs typically. So overall, we take from that that place or location is really a special commodity. They differ in their cost of living overall and in their amenities and environment. And so both of these differences may justify redistribution between places across households that have the same earnings. So that could lead to unique equity benefits of place-based redistribution that the income tax cannot replicate. Okay, so now here we turn to computing the difference in efficiency costs between place-based and income-based redistribution, as we just computed the difference in equity benefits. And here things are going to be easy. I recall that the cost of place-based redistribution depends on the earnings losses of movers. The income tax is going to have a very different type of efficiency cost. It's going to reduce the labor supply of all households in both locations. And so overall, the difference in efficiency costs between PBR reform and an income tax and a comparable income tax reform that has exactly the same tax effect is really the difference between these two terms, the earnings losses of movers versus the distortion of labor supply of all stayers, and which one dominates depends on context. And so putting both or putting everything together here, we get this condition that determines whether or not place-based redistribution improves welfare in the presence of an optimally chosen income tax. So it's going to be desirable if the place or the place-based redistribution specific equity benefits are at least as high as the net efficiency cost of place-based redistribution that we just discussed. And so place-based redistribution is going to improve welfare all the more as place-based targeting is going to provide specific equity gains, as migration rates are limited, as productivity differences are limited, and as labor supply responses are large. Okay, so you see from this expression that the desirability of PBR is really ultimately a horse race. And so we're going to now turn to a quantification exercise to gauge the desirability of PBR in our empirical context. And so to do that, we're going to proceed as follows. We're going to consider all tracts in the US. We're going to rank them by their poverty rate. And we're going to group them into groups that correspond each to 1% of the population. And we're going to ask, how much is the optimal per capita PBR or PBR transfer to the poorest groups of tracts, assuming that there's also an optimally chosen income tax put in place? And again, here, if PBR is not desirable, so if the equation I was showing you before leads to a negative evaluation, then this could very well be zero. So we're going to consider a utilitarian planner with equal weights on all households. And he's going to use two tools, a nonlinear place-blind income tax that we're going to approximate with three brackets, and a PBR scheme that's exactly as we discussed in the theory. And the planner is going to operate under budget balance. So to run the quantification exercise, we're going to have to make further parametric assumptions. And we're going to
Cecile?
Yeah.
Sorry to bother you, to interrupt you. There's a lot of questions, and I just wanted to make sure that you reserve some time at the end to address them. I'm going to ask them, ask the question when you're done, but
I'm gonna go very quickly. So over that, I'm gonna be done in a minute. Then, so I'm not gonna go into detail about how we calibrate this. Just let me say briefly, we're gonna basically calibrate the distribution of skills in the economy, as well as the distribution of amenities across those various groups of tracts. And the distribution of the productivity shifter of each city to match the distribution of income in the US and the distribution of income in each groups of tracts that we read from the census data. Okay, and I'm going to leave it at that in the interest of time. The planner maximizes welfare and chooses both the income tax and the place-based tax. And we find numerically that the optimum is reached for a place-based transfer of about $4,000 per resident of the poorest set of tracts. So we run various sensitivity analyses. I'm gonna skip that. And we have more exercises in progress. I'm also going to skip that, but happy to talk further. Basically, here, the two last plots show you that without putting in place a PBR, the distribution of poverty or the distribution of lambdas is much higher in distress. You have a lot of high lambda, so poor people in distress. And that's when you put in place the optimal income tax. When you put in place on top of it the optimal PBR, you see that the distribution of lambdas is shifted to the left. So basically, this allows, in practice, in this simulation, to alleviate much of the poverty in distress in a way that the income tax alone didn't fully manage to do. So I'm going to conclude here. I'm going to say that, you know, we show here that place-based redistribution can deliver unique equity and efficiency benefits. It can lead to low efficiency cost of taxation and can also lead to unique equity benefits that sometimes the income-based taxation cannot achieve. So compared to the public finance literature, we show that place constitutes a real-world example where tagging based on consumption choices may make sense. And compared to the urban and trade literature, we show that place-based policies can be justified by an equity motive beyond correcting for market failures. And so overall, the general takeaway is that there should be no presumption against helping poor places. The equity efficiency trade-off we face as a society in our redistributive goals can plausibly be improved by place-based redistribution as a complement to income-based redistribution.